Our first speaker is just working out the logistics with the AV people in the back. So we'll start in just about 1 minute. While we're waiting, I should just address a couple of things. Professor Carter, who just spoke, is the chief science advisor for the International Climate Science Coalition, and so I know his position quite well on things like acid, ocean acidification, things like that. And I should just point out to you that in his book, Climate, the Counter Consensus, which is advertised on our website, climatescienceinternational.org, he has a nice 7 pages that talks about ocean acidification and his position on that. Very easy to understand, starts right at the very basics, talks about what pH was like over the last 500 million years and the daily variations in pH that occur in the ocean, which are in fact greater than the, in some parts of the ocean, greater than the worst forecasts of the IPCC. So obviously those plants and animals have been able to adapt to much greater pH changes. But I refer you to Dr. Carter's book because he has a very nice 7 pages on that particular topic, which I cite from all the time. Just to answer one question that was put to Bob, we can expand on a little bit. The idea of educating teachers and educating students, that's an extremely important thing, of course, and the International Climate Science Coalition is building a speakers bureau, and one of our main targets is to speak at AGMs of science teachers, okay, across the United States and Canada, and eventually in other countries as well. But that's ongoing right now. We have a team of 8 scientists who are prepared to go out and speak in schools, but primarily at the AGMs for the science teachers. That's extremely important because, of course, they multiply your effort times many hundreds. So I've introduced myself previously. My name's Tom Harris. I'm with the International Climate Science Coalition. If you'd like to learn more about us, you can check our website that I just said or pick up one of the handouts at the side table. I won't say any more because I described our group previously. We have 3 speakers in this session, Professor Larry Bell, who's right here, who will be our first speaker, Mr. Steve Gorham, and Dr. Harrison Schmidt, who will be the 3rd speaker. I won't talk about the 2nd 2, I'll talk just about the person who's about to speak, and that is in particular Larry Bell. I'll introduce the others just before they speak. Larry Bell is endowed professor of space architecture at the University of Houston, okay? Now space, in this case we're talking about outer space, things like launch trajectories, trips to the moon, trips to Mars. That's the kind of space he's talking about, not building space like this. There he founded, at the University of Houston, he founded and directs the Sasakawa International Center for Space Architecture, and he heads the graduate program in space architecture. And I was just given this additional information. In addition to NASA awards, Dr. Bell has received 2 of the highest awards of the Russian Institute of Aeronautics and Cosmonautics from the former Soviet Union for international space development. And in fact, his name was placed on the outside of the first Russian rocket that went to the space station. So that's kind of an interesting claim to fame. He co-founded an American aerospace company that grew to employ more than 8,000 people. So he's well established in that field. But he's also a generalist as well and has expanded and writes on many topics. And in particular, he's a weekly columnist with Forbes.com and has authored numerous papers on all sorts of issues. They've appeared in professional journals and news releases around the world. He's most recently the author of a new book just released in January 2011, which is entitled Climate of Corruption, Politics and Power Behind the Global Warming Hoax. And he'll be signing his book between 11:15 and 11:45 out in the foyer. So without any further ado, I introduce Professor Bell.
I'm really glad to be here today. It's a real privilege, a real honor to be invited to come here. Since I spent so many of my years in academia, it's a rare honor and rare privilege to be with so many people I actually agree with. I'm not a climate scientist. I've never played one in the movies. I'm not connected with big oil, or little oil, or snake oil. I'm a space guy. And I never planned to write a book. A few years ago, Fred Singer visited my office on a totally unrelated subject. And in the course of conversation, Fred mentioned that, you know, the atmosphere in the radio sound and the satellites were telling a different story than the climate models were. And that's interesting. My mind was on something else at the time. My wife says, it always is. And she's right. And so it wasn't till maybe a year or two later that I got kind of interested in climate for a very dumb reason. I thought, well, you know, maybe there's something we can learn from climate systems that we can apply to, from spaceship Earth to spaceships, closed loop life support systems, closed systems. And I thought, you know, it's kind of goofy, but I get interested in goofy things. And so I started dabbling in climate science and began looking at it. I think one of the revelations was reading some of Lamb's stuff, climate history and other things. And the more I looked at it, the less sense it made what I was hearing. And I thought, either I'm nuts or there's some really nutty things being said. And I began to follow the money. I thought, now, who would put this stuff out there, which is so blatantly, obviously stupid, without a good reason? And I think one of the first revelations I had was I read some of Al Gore's testimony about cap and trade. He said, you know, as soon as we put a price on carbon, there's going to be unchained demand. Well, you know, I kind of follow the business markets. My wife does, and I listen. She likes Kudlow a lot more than she likes me. And it breaks my heart. But, you know, I'm looking at this stuff, and most of the people I hear who are talking about advice on stock and so on, they say, well, I must tell you, I own some of this stock. But here's what I'm investing in. I thought, well, Gore didn't tell me he was invested in carbon. That doesn't sound nice. I got infected with this stuff, and I got a bunch of information, and people said, well, why don't you write about it? And I said, well, okay. And then I started writing, and people say, well, do you believe in global warming? Yeah. I think it warms all the time. I moved to Houston intentionally. And so finally my family, you know, because I was boring people at cocktail parties, and they said, you got to write a book. You know, it's just a way to get me off their backs. So I wrote a book. And I wrote the book because I don't believe there's any scientific evidence of a climate crisis, because I think we're being lied to. Because I don't believe we're causing Greenland and Antarctica to melt. I was in Greenland, 1960, I spent a year there. A lot colder than when Eric the Red was there 1,000 years ago. I don't think the oceans are rising, and polar bears seem to be doing really well. Mark's picture yesterday, I thought was insightful. Apparently they're eating well. Carbon dioxide isn't a pollutant. Carbon dioxide is what makes plants grow. I wrote the book because I'm a parent, like the woman in the audience a few minutes ago. Because I care about the future, I care about my kids. I wrote the book because I think there's a crisis, I know there is, and it's political. I wrote the book because I had to. I hope you enjoy the drawings I did as much as I do. Oh, I guess I have to advance this, don't I?
That's the green one?
The green one. People are pushing our hot buttons. And it's not new. If we go back, according to the New York Times article, February 16, 2008, there was an article about ecotherapy. It's a new field. It's even bigger than climate science. And there's 120 ecotherapists now registered treating eco-anxiety about carbon footprints. And you'd think it was funny, you'd really think it was funny, except in March 2010, there was a family in Argentina that shot their children, they shot their two children and they killed themselves because they were about global warming. You know, so in a way it's funny, in a way it's tragic what we're seeing happening in our country. Why is carbon being demonized? I think the whole argument, much of the argument about climate science centers around carbon to advance a variety of agendas. One is the well-known cap and trade legislation to regulate fossil fuels, to make, quote, green energy, like everybody knows ethanol is green energy, right? It must be gross, it's green, to make it more cost competitive. To justify the green energy this craziness of the EPA's Clean Air Act, to appease powerful government lobbies, and to support a multi-billion dollar climate science industry based on alarmism. Little flashback here. 1923. Chicago Tribune headline. Scientists say Arctic ice will wipe out Canada. 1973, Science Digest, and a feature said, at this time, we do not have the comfortable distance of tens of thousands of years to prepare for the next ice age. Once the freeze starts, it's going to be too late. March 1st, 1975. This is the cover of Science News. Depicting a glacier covering New York City. It won't be the first time. The ice age cometh, noting clear and urgent threat. National Academy of Sciences agreed. Yet what happened less than two decades later? You know, I was understanding that climate is measured in like 30-year, you know, three-decade periods, but here it is less than about a half a decade later. And we have Al Gore convening his famous hearings in Washington, D.C., a warm summer. Somebody mentioned Timothy Gore the other day, remember? Timothy Gore helped plan the meeting. It was a warm summer in New England. I'm quoting Timothy Worth, rather. We called the Weather Bureau to find out what was historically the hottest day of the summer to schedule the hearings. What we did is we went in the night before and opened all the windows. The air conditioning in the room wasn't working. It was really hot. You all know who the star witness was. Al Gore, of course, got a lot of recognition and $250,000 award from the Teresa Hines Foundation for his climate science work, Nobel Prize for his movie. After he got the Hines Award, he endorsed John Kerry for his presidential bid. That's rather unusual. You know, I've worked around NASA for a lot of years. I don't know many civil servants endorsing presidential candidates publicly. Hansen did okay too. Hansen got the award for his science work. He also got he was a grantee from the George Soros Open Society Institute under the title of its Politicization of Science program. That's the program's actual name. IPCC. I know some friends that are trying to reform the IPCC. I don't think it makes any sense. I think they ought to abolish it. I think it is so flawed. Or at least we ought to withdraw from it. It was organized on a false pretense that human caused climate problem that's never been proven, never been established. Participants, as you know, are politically appointees of the international governments, often with little science experience. Politicians cherry pick and revise, even fabricate the conclusions of the reports. Climate models have been discussed. I've got 3 minutes, so I'm gonna move ahead here. Can you imagine with $14 trillion in debt and counting, we committed $100 billion a year to help other countries with their climate problems? Cap and trade has been discussed. Cap and trade legislation has no defensible purpose without a global warming crisis rationale. It's being promoted on three errant premises: to protect the planet from dangerous climate change caused by carbon pollution. There's no evidence of that. The premise that carbon dioxide restrictions will reduce fossil fuel energy consumption. Burden's going to be on the poorest of us. That carbon dioxide regulations will incentivize green energy. We've had a lot of discussion about that. Look at Spain, look at Europe. Doesn't happen. Some of you know, and I think Christopher Horn mentioned this, the Enron was really behind the cap and trade business. Back in the 1990s, they owned the largest natural gas pipeline outside of Russia. And they were having a hard time competing with coal, with natural gas. And this, the acid rain thing did a great deal to create a market for sodium dioxide, carbon trading. And there's an internal memo said within Enron said, Kyoto Protocol would do more to promote Enron's business than almost any other regulatory initiative outside the restructuring of the natural gas industries in Europe and the US. You probably know about Gore's Generation Investment Management, Chicago Climate Exchange, Shore Bank in Chicago, and that murky bunch of characters. We have a hero here, Alan Carlin, sitting in front. The endangerment finding was put through despite Alan's report Given the downward trend in temperatures since 1998, which some think will continue until at least 2030, there's no particular reason to rush into decisions based upon a scientific hypothesis that does not appear to explain most of the available data. Of course, they ignored it. This is alternative energy. It's going to solve our problems for us, of course. Hate coal, right? I want to conclude very quickly here. With something that was taken, that I took from the Carbon Sense Coalition based in Australia, titled Proof Please, Not Propaganda. And I get a lot of responses on my Forbes articles. The following argument for which this was issued was issued by the chairman, Viv Forbes. We need proof that carbon dioxide is a pollutant in the atmosphere. There is none, only political propaganda. We need proof that global temperatures are controlled by man-made carbon dioxide. There is none. Only computer models that are fiddled to fit the past but unable to predict the future. We need proof on how emission targets will be achieved, especially if the big emitters are exempted and consumers are compensated. How many power stations, steel furnaces, cement plants will need to close? What will replace them and when? We need an independent audit into the mishmash of mandates and subsidies promoting ethanol, solar, wind, carbon, and carbon trading industries. There is none, only government spewers and lobbyists for vested interests. We need proof that a tax on carbon dioxide will produce net benefits for the climate or for the environment. There is none. Just scare stories, misleading pictures, and green fairy tales. On the other hand, there is voluminous evidence that carbon dioxide is a beneficial plant food, not a pollutant. That government temperatures are set by natural cycles and processes. That a tax on carbon dioxide will increase living costs and close Australian industries, and that the climate agenda has more to do with wealth distribution than with climate or with the environment. Thank you very much.